Now I turn to Dimitri Kochanov, who is a professor at the University of Groningen and holds the chair in European Constitutional Law and Citizenship. So again, you have 12 minutes. I know it's very hard, but...
Thank you very much. It's a huge honor to be here, and it's great to see all the faces of the greatest experts with whose work I live every day, basically. So it's an honor to be here, and I will be building on what Paul said, of course, and what Ramona presented in providing a different perspective. So what I would like to focus on, and it draws in part on the paper which I shared, that paper is just one third of the argument I intend to build. What I would like to focus on is the other side, the EU side of sovereignty claims concerning the rule of law as applied to the European Union. So something that will focus on the Court of Justice mostly, but not only. So we've heard about the problem. We know what backsliding is about. We know that Hungary and Poland are in many ways derailed, and the European Union cannot do much. But as the recent case law teaches us, in fact, the Court of Justice, together with the Commission, and here I can retell in part the story that Paul Craig has already mentioned, started the rule of law revolution. So what we go through from the Portuguese judges when the Court of Justice found competence, essentially, to rethink Article 19 and to make it... turn it into a trigger of the rule of law scrutiny for supranational level, engaging with the national level. Building on that, we had Commission versus Poland, we had AK, we had Nestorovich, we had plenty of cases which are of fundamental significance. What is their significance? The Court of Justice for the first time told us, actually, our rule of law is not simply circular legality, what we know from Levert. It's something that has clear substance. And this clear substance, as the Court of Justice has built it so far, is centered mostly on the principle of independence of the judiciary. Of course, it's an important part of the rule of law. It's not all of the rule of law, but the Court of Justice approaches this issue from the point of view of clear constraints of Article 19. So Article 19 plus Article 12 leave us with judicial independence. Judicial independence is already something, and judicial dependence is already a significant move forward compared with Levert, in my understanding. But then this is all a great story. The Court of Justice engages actively in promoting a substantive idea of the rule of law, which it then offers the Commission to enforce with the Court's help, of course, at the national level. Now let's look at the other side of the same coin. How does the Court of Justice apply the cardinal principles of judicial independence and irremovability from office before the expiration of the legally established mandate? How does it apply the post-Levert understanding of the rule of law to the supranational sovereign in our system? So, and here I think the Court of Justice, unfortunately, and this is my only claim in this paper, comes up with a second standard of the rule of law, which remains largely procedural, and which remains very often even weaker than the Levert standard of legality. So I have three examples in mind, which I plan to deploy in order to explain the emergence of this double standard. The first example is the way how the Court of Justice uses the rule of law rhetoric in order to preempt any kind of substantive criticism of the substance of EU law. So rule of law becomes a passe-partout tool in order to defend supremacy and direct effect of EU law. And this is something that we saw in Opinion 213. So Opinion 213, it's already quite old, but it's a reminder, it's a warning. It's a warning that we all heard that EU legal system can sometimes prioritize procedural justifications over the respect of the substance of rights. So I would only cite Bruno De Witte, who co-wrote with Shaili Imamovic a wonderful paper entitled "The Court of Justice Defending Europeans from Foreign Human Rights." This is what happens. So this is the way how the rule of law is understood and deployed at the supranational level. And I called it rule of law as a tool to claim supremacy. Of course, it's not necessary to claim supremacy anymore. Supremacy is established, supremacy is well-founded, it's part of our law, yet it's kind of new to use rule of law rhetoric and rule of law understandings in order to prevent any kind of contestation potentially coming from the level of the human rights protection system. And the same would apply, of course, to the contestation by the national courts, Bundesverfassungsgericht, this dialogue with the Corte Costituzionale, Tarikko Saga, etc., etc. The Court of Justice always uses as the starting point its claim of rule of law supremacy. We saw this in the press release as well, in a way, with which the Court of Justice responded to the claims to the Bundesverfassungsgericht's position. The second example which I had in mind is the Achmea case law and all what happened with bilateral investment treaties in the EU and the treatment by the Commission together with the court of the tribunals put in place in order to defend investments largely from Western European member states to Eastern European member states. It's clear to quote Wojciech Sadowski, who wrote an excellent paper on this in the Common Market Law Review, it's clear that the understanding of the rule of law embraced by the Court of Justice eliminates an idea of replication of the same function. So the rule of law is understood as an idea which is incompatible to allowing several judicial bodies deciding potentially on similar matters and duplicating each other. So rule of law turns into an instrument to combat essentially any kind of pluralism in adjudication at the supranational level. So it's new in a way to hear that the rule of law and the coherence of European judiciary, which is fully in line with Article 19, is in fact something that implies the necessity to destroy legal pluralism. And then, of course, the implications are drastic, especially if we look at the investments into Hungary and Poland, and there are billions and billions invested, because after Achmea, immediately the governments of both countries started introducing this argument that any kind of protection of investments under the bilateral BITs is illegal under EU law, so they are not obliged, in fact, even to say thank you when they're expropriating investments. And I have recently published a paper together with a Greek colleague that looks at the concrete examples of such expropriations coming especially from Hungary. We had Chèque de Jeunet when a French company lost all its investments in Hungary because of a purposeful change in legislation, which would be captured by the BIT rules, but would never be captured by EU law. And another example is concerning the land investments into Hungarian land, exactly the same. So by going against pluralism, the European Court of Justice, together with the Commission, undermined the position of investments in the European legal space. Unfortunately,
3 minutes.
And this is 3 minutes, right? And this is how rule of law is used. And the third example, which I had in mind, which is probably the most unfortunate one, is the example of kicking out of the court the British Advocate General Shopston. And this is the paper. I shared, which happened in direct violation of the basic principles of legality, and sent a very strange signal to the member states and to the all that the Court of Justice does not enjoy structural independence from the member states. So if we look at what the Vice President of the Court of Justice wrote in response to the secret appeal from a body collective of the member states that doesn't exist in EU law and cannot be sued, but apparently could secretly appeal, we learned that whatever the member states decide, even if they decide not on the basis of the article that would authorize them to take a decision, even if they act ultra vires and even if they act in direct violation of all of the treaties, that's fine and that's not reviewable. So the Court of Justice has supported this position formally via the vice president and informally via the organization of this whole matter, to the extent that one of the sitting members of the court was kicked out before the expiration of the legally binding mandate. So the situation arose where the Court of Justice has one standard, the cardinal principle of judicial independence and irremovability, which is applicable, for instance, to Justice Gersdorf of the Polish Supreme Court. And then there is another standard which says the masters of the treaty hold the only powerful position and their decisions, which are illegal and not reviewable. This is the standard that applies to the members of the Court of Justice itself. So the bottom line, these three examples, I think, point into a very dangerous direction of the emergence of a double standard in terms of the rule of law and the potential abuse of the sovereignty claim, which is connected to the rule of law understanding, which we have at the supranational level by the European Union. So stiffening pluralism, going against the basic legality and primary law, and also using the rule of law as a justification not to extend human rights protections to EU citizens, this is something that is deeply dangerous, and we should watch this very closely. Thank you very much.